The Ministry of Secondary Education has developed a distance learning platform for students of secondary education in Cameroon. A series of lessons taught by qualified teachers for secondary school students. Under the stewardship of Professor Pauline Nalovalyonga in collaboration with the Ministry of Posts and Telecommunications, CAMTEL, CRTV, and UNESCO, we are introducing distance learning as another teaching and learning method which is different from the traditional classroom setting that you are all used to. In the distance education mode, you are not with the teacher in person, so take your time, relax, listen to the teacher, take down notes and visit the following links for any questions or answers to your questions. Take it in your stride. This is Cameroon's solution to COVID-19 and beyond. Professor Nalovalyonga, Minister of Secondary Education.
Welcome to this learning session. I am D. John Stani, a mathematics teacher. I will be assisting you in your study of mathematics in Form 1. Let me begin by congratulating you for going through the primary school program successfully, and now you are in Form 1. If you were already in Form 1 and you didn't succeed to get to Form 2, there is no big deal. The only thing is that you should be able to figure out where you went wrong or where you made an error in how you were studying, and then put in more efforts and you will be able to succeed. I hope that you will enjoy the time we will have studying mathematics. So let's move on to see how the program for Form 1 will look like. We will have a general presentation of the syllabus. Then we will have the general objectives and the competencies to be developed. That is to say that we will learn, or I will indicate to you what you will be able to do when we would have finished with the Form 1 program by the end of the year. We will also look at the prerequisite knowledge. That is to say, what are you supposed to know already so that you can be able to do the Form 1 program effectively? Let's begin with the general presentation of the Form 1 mathematics syllabus. Form 1 program, or for the syllabus for mathematics for Form 1, is divided into four modules, namely numbers and operations in the set of numbers. Then we have introduction to plane geometry, solid figures, and elementary statistics. These are the four modules that we will do by the end of this 1 year in Form 1. Let's look a bit detailly into numbers and operations in the set of numbers. That module contains the following subtopics. We have numbers and numerals, the set of natural numbers, the set of integers. Then we will also study time, number patterns, the set of rational numbers. We will look at decimals, arithmetic processes. Then when we would have finished with that, we will go into the second module, which is introduction to plane geometry. There we will look at plane figures, line segments, circles, angles, triangles. We will also look at quadrilaterals and symmetry. Then, from there we will go to the module titled solid figures. Under solid figures, we will look at cubes, cuboids, and cones. We will equally look at right circular cylinders. Then we will end the year by looking at elementary statistics. Under that, we will look at the collection of simple data, and we will also study how we can represent data. So that's how the various modules are subdivided. Now, let's look at the objectives and the competencies or the skills that will be developed when we would have gone through the Form 1 syllabus. The first objective or the first purpose of this study of Form 1 mathematics will be to consolidate the concepts treated in primary school. That is to say that there are a lot of things you studied in Form 1, in primary school. We will start from there to make sure that you have mastered it very well. To do that, we will study numbers. We will study Roman numerals. We will revise again Hindu-Arabic numerals, natural numbers and operations. Then we will also look at number bases, which we did again in primary school. We'll look at number patterns. We will also look at decimals, arithmetic processes, plain figures, and solid figures. These are things you studied in Form 1, which we are still going to do it and master it more. But we will not end at that level. After we would have consolidated that, after we would have mastered the primary school work well, we will equally discover new concepts. So we will go into numbers, number sets, where we will study the set of integers and rational numbers even more detailed. We will study time, dot patterns of numbers. We will look at plane figures, where we will deal with points and lines. We will look at quadrilaterals more detailed. Then we will look at plane symmetry, coordinate geometry, and simple statistics. When we would have gone through all of this, we will use the concepts we have learned and use it to solve mathematical and real-life problems. That said, let me tell you some of the things you need to know so that you can be able to do Form 1 program successfully and effectively. The first thing is that you should be capable of using the four arithmetic operations. Thus, you should be able to add numbers, subtract numbers, multiply numbers, and divide numbers. This will help you very much as you go on in the program for Form 1. You should also be able to identify and carry out basic operations with fractions. That is to say that if you are given two fractions to add or to subtract or to multiply and even divide, you should be comfortable in doing that. Then you should also be capable of carrying out division in the set of natural numbers. I mean divisions where you divide two whole numbers and the answer is a decimal. You should be capable of doing that. What I want you to understand by these things I've mentioned is the fact that if you have some few difficulties about these things or you have forgotten some of them, it will be good you revise it so that as we go on with our program, you will not have difficulties. Another thing that you will also need to revise or need to be comfortable with is to identify and apply ratios and percentages to solve simple worded problems. You should also be capable of identifying and calculating the area of common plane figures like squares, rectangles. You should be capable and comfortable in solving such problems, so calculating areas of such plane figures. That said, let's get now into module 1. The first module that we will be looking at is numbers and operations in the set of numbers. This module is subdivided into subtopics, and there are 8 of those subtopics, and each subtopic is further subdivided into lessons or organized into lessons. This is how it is structured. We will look at numbers and numerals, and there we will do 8 lessons. We will look at the sets of natural numbers, and there we will have 4 lessons. Then we will look at a set called the set of integers, Don't bother if you've never heard of it. We will do it and you will enjoy it. We will have 6 lessons. Then we will also look at time, and there we will have 3 lessons. It doesn't end there. We will also look at number patterns. There we will have 9 lessons. And then we will look at then we will look at the set of rational numbers. There we will have 7 lessons. Then we will look at decimals, which will be, we will do 6 lessons there, and arithmetic processes, which we will do 8 lessons. Let's start with the first subtopic, which is numbers and numerals. Now, like I said, numbers and numerals is subdivided into a number of lessons. We have 8 lessons there, and the lessons are as follows. We have history of numbers. We have the Egyptian and the Roman numerals. Then we will look at Hindu-Arabic numerals. And we will also look at number bases and operations. Now, let's look at our first lesson. The first lesson is titled The History of Numbers. This lesson will follow this plan. We will start with the objectives of the lesson. We'll go to an introduction. Then we will look at prerequisite knowledge, or what you need to know before you are capable of doing this lesson well. Then we will look at problem situation. Then we will have a learning activity, and we will take a summary. We will go into exercises of application, and then an assignment to end the lesson. Without any waste of time, let's look at the objectives. What is the purpose of this lesson? We hope that by the end of this lesson, you who would have gone through the lesson, you should be able to state some examples of the early number systems. You should also be capable of explaining why some number systems are more preferable than others. And lastly, you should be able to describe the development of a number system or of number systems. The issue of numbers, or the story of numbers, dates back as far as the time of ancient people. Because as man began living on earth and communities were formed, there was a need to keep track of items that they had, of time, and of distance. When you reflect on that, you discover that when man was rearing animals, gathering fruits, there was a need to know how many things you had. And sometimes along the line in history, there was the development of trade. People moved from one place to the other, like the Indians. They did trade and went right to Europe. But there was no standard units that people could use to compare quantities that they had. And when trade began in those ancient civilizations, it was what we used to call trade by barter. It was not trade that you have a currency, a fixed currency that you can use, like today we have the franc CFA, we have the dollar, the euro, and etc. So someone will bring a certain number of items, and then another one brings the others, and then you exchange. So it is necessary to know how many things I need to give you. Maybe if I bring cocoyams and I need oranges from you or to trade with you, I should know how many oranges will be exchanged with how many cocoyams. So there was that need to have the issue of numbers established. So studying numbers and the history of numbers is of paramount importance, because it helps us to know how, with various civilizations as they have grown up, how numbers were invented and how they have evolved over the years. For you to be able to effectively do this lesson, it will be necessary that you should know how to read and write numbers using the decimal system or the base 10 system. Let's look at this problem. Many years ago, before civilization began, the ancient man had no idea about numbers. Now, in your opinion, what do you think they used to keep track of their belongings? The fact that they had no idea of numbers, can you imagine how they were keeping track of their numbers? Okay, let's move on a bit. We'll have other things to do and then we'll reflect on that later on. Now, let's look at this learning activity. Now, I would like you to assume you are a sheep herder or you are a shepherd. You are taking care of sheep. And you are charged with keeping track of the herds of sheep. That is to say that the owner of the sheep wants that you should know whether the sheep are all intact all the time. No sheep is missing and no strange sheep gets into the sheep that you are taking care of. So imagine that you have never thought of numbers. I know you already know about numbers because we have used it in primary school. Even back at home, we usually count. But let's just assume for a moment, or imagine for a moment that you know nothing about numbers. And you have no symbols that we use to represent numbers. You know nothing about that. But every morning and every evening, you want to be sure that all the sheep are there and no wandering sheep has entered into the sheep you are taking care of. No, any of your sheep has gone away. How do you think you can do this? When you don't know anything about numbers, you don't know how to represent numbers with symbols. What do you think you can do? What can be a solution to be able to be sure that the sheep are not missing, no sheep is missing, and no wandering sheep has entered into your own sheep? Okay, there are two possible solutions that can be used. One of it is for you to gather pieces of stones, or get a good number, large number of stones, or what we usually call pebbles. That are small pieces of stones. You gather all of them together, and then in the morning, you can bring all the sheep and put in an enclosed area. And you make the sheep to move out to go out for grazing one after the other. And you arrange them in such a way that they don't move in a mass. As each sheep goes out, you take one pebble or one stone and you keep by the side. You continue like that, one sheep, one pebble, one sheep, one stone, until all the sheep have gone out and you have put exactly the same number of pebbles corresponding to the sheep that have gone out. If there are some left over or some excess stones still left, you can discard them. And the pile that you have mounted represents the number of sheep that have gone out. The moment you are bringing back the sheep in the evening, you can now go again and make sure they enter into the sheep pen one after the other. As they are entering, you are taking from that pile of stones one after the other. When one sheep enters, you take one pebble and put again by the side. You start removing from that pile and putting until all the sheep have entered. If the last sheep enters the pen, and you discover that the last pebble has been removed, it means that no sheep is missing and no strange sheep has entered into your own sheep. But if you discover that one pebble is still left or some pebbles are still left while the sheep are no longer there, it means that some might have been eaten by a wild animal or a thief caught some in the bush. It means that not all the sheep have entered. If you also discover that you have finished with the pebbles and some sheep are still hanging around, it means that maybe another sheep strayed into your own. That's one way you can do that, without using numbers, without using the representation of numbers. The second possibility is that you can take a large stone, you keep by the side, and you take maybe a piece of stone where you can make a mark on that rock. You get a large rock, you get a small piece that you, a stone that you can be making marks on the rock, such that as the sheep are going out one after the other, when one sheep goes out, you make a mark on that big stone. You continue like that until all the sheep has gone out, and then you have marks on the rock to indicate that you have counted all the sheep. And when they are coming back, you can start crossing those marks that you had made on the rock to confirm that all the sheep have returned. Those are the kinds of ways problems like that could be handled, even without knowing about numbers. Now, in summary, we want to say, for thousands of years, humans used various forms of tallies, various ways of keeping track, of counting things. Some used stones, some used sticks. But maintaining a large pile of stones or pieces of sticks and long lists of tallies became cumbersome. It became difficult. You can even put that pile of stones and then maybe someone comes and playing, children are playing around and they scatter the stones. It will confuse you when you are verifying your sheep in the evening. So there was a need to develop numbers, to know about numbers. And so the need grew all the more as numbers were necessary for us to be, for human beings to keep track of these things that they had. Throughout history, different methods have been used to denote numbers, so that when you count and you know, you can just represent with a symbol. The ancient Babylonians developed a system where they were using base 60, which means that they had 60 symbols to do their representation. It may look like base 60 is out of place. No, we still use it even today. It may interest you to remember that when we count seconds, when we are dealing with time, 60 seconds make 1 minute, and 60 minutes make 1 hour. That's base 60. So the Babylonians did what we are still using today. The Mayan civilization was another civilization that existed in ancient days, and they used base 20. So they had 20 symbols to denote numbers. The Greeks, the Egyptians, the Indians, and the Romans also came up with numbering systems, different numbering systems. And about 700 or 7 century years ago, the Indians improved upon their system of numbering, and they were able to invent or have a symbol for the concept of nothing. You know, all along there was that idea of having, but there was also the possibility that you may not have. And so they were able to invent a symbol that represented nothing, when you have nothing. The discovery of zero. Finally, around 500 AD, a number system cropped up or was developed that introduced the symbol for zero. In the Hindu-Arabic system, which is the system that we have developed our own from, there was also a placeholder, there was a symbol that was to represent zero, or lack of everything, that we don't have something. And they developed a number of symbols which ranged from 1 to 9, which they were using. This is what we call the decimal system, and it is what we have adopted in the modern system for mathematics. That said, let's now look at these exercises of application. We have a question. Mr. Angu, a prominent businessman, created a secret number code to keep records of his savings in his hidden safe in his house. He decided that capital T will stand for 10,000, capital H will represent 100,000, and L will stand for 1 million. Any amount that was less than 10,000, he will not save it. But any amount that was from 10,000 upward, he will save it. Using those letters, he can mark it somewhere. And when you see it, you will not know how much he has saved, but he can know it. So in one of his recordings, he wrote HTT. So how much was it that he had saved? We will want to have the answer written in words. The second question, one day one of his debtors paid his debt of 2,300,000 francs. How did he record this amount using that his secret code? And finally, how can you develop his number code such that they can be able to record, or he can be able to record the list to the least 1,000 francs? That's even if he has 1,000 francs, he can still record it. Let's look at the solution. Since he wrote on one of his recordings, he had HTT, and we said H stood for 100,000, and then T was 10,000. So since there are two T's, it means 20,000. So the amount was 120,000. A debtor paid him 2,300,000. So if he were to record it, he would record something like LLHHH. The two L stands for 2 million, and then 300,000 is represented by 3H or triple H. That's why we have LLHHH. Finally, if we were to help him, you can decide that you will enable him to record to the least 1,000 by creating a numeral for 1,000. That's to say that instead of having just those three numerals, we introduce another numeral which will represent 1,000. In that way, it will help him when he's recording even 1,000, he can record it comfortably. Now, I will leave you with an assignment. It's always good to do something later on your own, so that it will help you to be able to understand even the lesson the more and concretize what you have already learned. The assignment is this. If you look, you will see a picture. The diagram below represents a method that was used to keep track of the number of items by an ancient man. What do you suggest was the number of items he had? Just study that figure, that diagram carefully, and suggest what you think could have been the number of items that he had before representing it that way. The second question that I would like you to look at is, what symbol did the Egyptians use to represent zero? If you do not know the answer directly, you can do a search, do some research, just ask some people. If you have the opportunity of coming on Google, you can just check to see whether you can get the answer. When we will get into the next lesson, when we will be doing the correction, you will learn more. Thank you very much for your keen attention. Our next lesson will be on Egyptian and Roman numerals. See you in the next lesson, and thank you again.
Una tege si matege yok, una tege minga matege nyum, una tege majang matege ndom, mane tambia ninya ne njubyayen, ngani bana matege mot, ngani la kiri watege ndong, esekina biya dinkido, mane tambia ninya.